January 6th, 2021 was one of the most dramatic moments in recent American history. Supporters of Donald Trump stormed Congress in a bid to keep their man in power. And the consequences continue to reverberate today.
A jury in the U.S. finds members of the Proud Boys group guilty of seditious conspiracy.
But the man who's been given the longest sentence for his part in the riot wasn't even in Washington that day. Enrique Tarrio was the leader of a far-right group called the Proud Boys.
Nobody will understand the Proud Boys until you're in it. I think it's like a regular group of men that are just tired of being trampled on.
I'm Mike Wendling, and in this week's episode of Trending's Extreme series, we'll hear extracts from exclusive interviews with Tarrio, including from behind prison bars, as we take a look at the extremes of American politics.
From this point forward, enough is enough. Force will be met with force.
We'll hear from others who belong to extreme political groups and look at how they rally, recruit, and spread their messages on social media.
Even social media is becoming quite polarized and quite political, and I think that's something that we're going to see a lot more of.
This call is from a correction facility and is subject to monitoring and recording.
Hello?
Hey.
Hey. How's it going?
Oh, hey.
I first started speaking to Enrique Tarrio back in early 2020. I was covering stories about people on the far right and on the far left, and I spent some time with anti-fascist protesters and then with militia groups. But then there was this one group, the Proud Boys. They were starting to pop up in all the headlines and newspaper reports, and every time there were a TV report about protests, it was something about the Proud Boys, and I kept hearing this name, Enrique Tarrio.
So how have you been feeling since the sentencing?
I mean, I think I'm still like, it's unrealistic to me. You know, it's just, that number is just ridiculous. I'm sorry for what those people went through, but I'm not responsible for that.
Last month, Enrique Tarrio was sentenced to 22 years in prison for his role in the riot in Washington on January the 6th, 2021. And the reporter he's talking to is Maxine Hughes, one of our colleagues who's been covering extremist groups for nearly a decade. She's had a front row seat as Donald Trump's presidency divided the country, embedding with some of the leading figures on the violent fringes of U.S. politics.
Ladies and gentlemen, repeat after me. I am a Western chauvinist.
I am a Western chauvinist.
The Proud Boys were one of the main far-right groups present at the Capitol riot, and until recently, Tarrio was their leader. They're a club that began in the white-hot heat of the 2016 presidential election, the one that Donald Trump actually won. Since then, they've become known for their street violence, their heavy drinking, and their hatred of left-wingers. They claim to be upholding traditional values, and they call themselves freedom-loving Western chauvinists. Last month, Maxine and I were in the courthouse when Tarrio received that 22-year sentence for his role in the Capitol riot. During his sentencing hearing, we watched as he said he felt shame and admitted that even before January the 6th, he had doubts about the so-called big lie, Donald Trump's claim that the 2020 election was stolen. Yet it was that claim that prompted people to storm the Capitol, and Tarrio has been named as one of the main instigators. What do we know about this man, and what led him to this point?
When you get to know about this guy, you learn that he's an Afro-Cuban who has grown up in Miami. He still has family in Cuba and strong links there. So he didn't ever look like the other far-right leaders. Tarrio initially told me that his raison d'etre was about stopping Antifa, which is basically a leaderless far-left protest movement who often counter and clash with the far-right groups, both online and offline. The Proud Boys felt that America was under attack, that it was under attack from the far left, from socialism, from communism, and that they had to get out and defend it. And when I spoke to Tarrio about Antifa in 2020, he compared the movement to domestic terrorism, which is an accusation I'm sure they would strongly reject.
I believe Antifa does have the right to free speech. I'd be contradicting my own views by saying that they don't. I think they do need a voice in this conversation. I think every American needs a voice in this conversation, but the line is very simple where we draw it. It's violence. Acts of vandalism, burning down private businesses, shooting people in the street. I mean, that's terrorism, what you're trying to do. You're trying to enact political change through violence, acts of violence. And that's exactly what terrorism is.
I was sitting with Enrique Tarrio a few years ago in Florida. This was at a point where he said that he wanted to stand back from the Proud Boys and that he wanted to go into mainstream politics. But he never really was able to do that in the way that maybe he wanted to. And, you know, he'd taken this route that had led him down this path of extremism.
Nobody will understand the Proud Boys until you're in it for, you know, a good amount of time and you start understanding what it is. I think it's like a regular group of men that are just tired of being trampled on. They feel like they were forgotten.
And once he got a taste for it, that was that. He just kept going further and further down this hole.
Well, I think all of us are silenced for the most part. Like, the media is never going to portray us properly.
The media is never going to portray us properly. It's a complaint you hear often from groups and individuals on both the far left and right. Groups that often claim to represent the mainstream of American politics. And sure, things like traditional values or anti-fascism can seem like common sense political views. But there is one thing that marks these groups out from the mainstream: their willingness to use violence.
I'll break him out. Do something.
While Tarrio insisted the Proud Boys were just a regular group of men who drew the line at acts of violence, in places such as Portland, Oregon, demonstrations involving the Proud Boys would frequently descend into brawls and beatings. That's not to suggest that the Proud Boys were the sole instigators of violence at these events, but according to the Armed Conflict Location and Event Data Project, in the year the Capitol was stormed, 2021, nearly a quarter of all demonstrations attended by the Proud Boys included violence. These men may have felt forgotten, but their activities garnered enough attention to warrant a mention by Joe Biden and Donald Trump during a presidential debate in 2020, in a response to a question about white supremacist and militia groups.
Proud Boys, stand back and stand by, but I'll tell you what.
Before the debate stage mention, we had 22,000 Proud Boys worldwide. And it's not hard to see that our numbers have been doubled since then.
From my conversations with Enrique Tarrio, I'm not sure whether he truly believed the election was stolen or that it was even possible for it to be stolen. But the majority of the group that he was leading did believe that. And I think he felt this pressure to stick to the narrative. I think he was in a position where he kind of felt he had no other choice in a way. And Donald Trump kept reinforcing this line too, of course.
Tarrio himself wasn't actually in Washington, D.C. on January 6th. He'd been arrested and ordered to leave the city 2 days before. But prosecutors used messages he posted on Telegram and another social network, Parler, to argue that he both planned the Proud Boys operation and encouraged people to join in the violent assault on the Capitol. A group Tarrio set up on Telegram was called the Ministry of Self-Defense. On the day of the riot, Tarrio wrote, "Make no mistake, we did this." At the trial of Tarrio and four other Proud Boys earlier this year, prosecutors introduced into evidence an enormous stash of messages demonstrating how they planned to show up in Washington and talked for weeks about violence and civil war. Tarrio was convicted of a number of felony crimes, including seditious conspiracy, a charge just short of treason. And while messages were instrumental in the prosecution of Tarrio, Proud Boy chapters around the U.S. show no sign of slowing down their online activities. On Telegram, there are at least 36 different U.S. Proud Boy chapters. That's not the full picture, because some chapters aren't active on the platform and other channels may be private. But the ones we can see have a total of tens of thousands of followers. We looked through some of the recent messages across these groups and found posts in support of the Proud Boys being sentenced for the Capitol riot, calls to free them, and descriptions of them as political prisoners.
When I spoke to Tarrio recently from prison, he was pretty clear that whilst he maybe felt sorry for what happened at the riots, because he wasn't present in Washington, D.C. that day, he won't apologise for his role in it. He says he didn't do it. But I think what his sentencing shows us is that regardless of whether he was there on the day or not, activity online can have offline, real-world consequences. And the ongoing investigations into the events of January 6th aren't contained to what happened on the day of January 6th, but events both offline and online around it. In the call I had with Tarrio from prison, he made an allegation that prosecutors and the FBI offered him leniency if he would help them prove that he communicated indirectly with President Trump during the build-up to the attack, This wasn't the first time he's claimed this either. The Washington Post and New York Times have also reported this claim.
They wanted to offer me a plea.
Oh, I see. But what did they offer you?
They didn't tell me because I didn't verify their version of the story.
What's their version of the story?
They wanted me to confirm that I was communicating with the president through 3 degrees of separation of people, and somehow we're communicating together to coordinate whatever it is that happens at the Capitol. Again, it sounds like a cool Tom Clancy novel, but it's not true.
Trump says he didn't know who Tarrio was until recently. I contacted the U.S. Department of Justice about this claim, and they told me they aren't able to comment on ongoing matters.
I also contacted Tarrio's lawyer to ask if he could corroborate the story. His lawyer said that he could confirm that this meeting did take place, but he wasn't able to comment on what was actually said in the meeting.
We do know from court records that Tarrio was offered a plea deal, but Trump wasn't mentioned in the official documents. And if the former president did come up, maybe it was just an example of prosecutors pushing for more information. But it certainly suits the narrative Donald Trump is trying to build, that he is a victim of a witch hunt. Is that why Tarrio is so keen to tell reporters about it? We've heard how social media was instrumental in helping Tarrio and others plan the Capitol attack. And we've seen how social media helps glue together and galvanize different Proud Boy chapters, even as their leaders face long prison sentences, and Donald Trump faces his own laundry list of legal woes. But what about the role social media could play in not only facilitating the organizing of violence, but also in enabling the recruitment of people to extreme groups on either side of the political spectrum, and pushing their views and actions even further? As well as the Proud Boys, Maxine also followed other organizations operating at the extremes of U.S. politics, a movement called the Three Percenters on the right, and a loose collection of anti-fascist Antifa activists on the left, both of which were actively involved in organizing and recruiting on social media, and both sides are armed.
Three targets, two paper, one steel.
The militia itself is a well-armed populace. We're citizens, you know, one. Two, we have the right to bear arms. So you bring those two components together, and that is the militia.
Chris Hill was the leader of the 3% militia in Georgia. The name of the movement, which includes many disparate groups, refers to a shaky historical theory that just 3% of the population of the American colonies actively resisted British rule during the Revolutionary War in the 18th century. At one point, Chris Hill was a pretty popular guy. He was getting large groups of people to give up their free time, dress up in military gear, and spend weekends in the forest training for what they thought was going to be a civil war.
We have treason happening in the United States of America, so I want my country back. We will defend ourselves and our communities and our fellow Americans from what we see as a communist, you know, act of terrorism being perpetrated on the people from these left-leaning organizations.
So Chris Hill was prolific on Facebook at one time, back in 2019 and 2020. It was what Chris Hill was using to get his message out and to recruit people. And I think it was successful in reaching a wider, more mainstream audience. I was there in a forest in Georgia at one of their training weekends back in 2020, and there were several new members who had come along who said they'd seen the postings on Facebook and decided to join. But Chris Hill became increasingly concerned about using Facebook, and so he started to demand that the group stop using Facebook Messenger to discuss plans for protests and move to what they deemed would be safer platforms.
While Chris was initially using social media to bring members into the fold of the Three Percenters, on the other side of the political spectrum, social media videos of George Floyd protests were prompting a woman named Emily to become more involved in the political activism of Antifa.
Antifa are against oppression, and that's why Antifa are involved in the Black Lives Matter movement. It's kind of interesting even to watch the way that my own views of it have changed. I said the words, I'm not a crazy person, because of the way that the media has decided to spin Antifa, the way that it has been spun in the past.
Emily's from Portland. She's always been very left-wing. She started to adopt Antifa as an identity for herself, and she got more and more involved. It just completely took over her life to the point that she lost her job. And she herself describes herself as being radicalized.
When I am not there, I feel like I'm letting my people down. And if something were to happen to somebody that I love and I wasn't there, that would be heartbreaking. Our nights off, I think we all do it. It's just like furiously scrolling through social media or watching live streams to make sure that our friends are safe.
As Emily and Chris traveled further down their social media rabbit holes, being fed content, confirming their realities, and feeding their frustrations, it would only be a matter of time before clashes between their respective groups came to a head, as we saw in August 2020 at a protest that took place in Georgia.
Atlanta Antifa, we got your banner. We're gonna meet you August 15th, Stone Mountain, Georgia. You're traitors to the Constitution, you're traitors to our way of life, and from this point forward, enough is enough, force will be met with force.
Does anybody have any more shields?
I think for me, the scariest experience that I had was when there was a protest at Stone Mountain in Georgia. It was militia groups there mostly, the three percenters against the far-left anti-fascist protesters. And both groups on that day were armed. And we got to a point where they were all very close to each other. They started shouting at each other, hurling insults at each other. And at one point, somebody from the far left pulled a gun out. He didn't point it, but he did pull it out in quite a threatening way. And as soon as he did that, all of the militia lifted their guns. And these are, you know, AR rifles. And there we are standing right in the middle of both sides. I think largely a lot of anger is because people feel that they are not heard.
Hi, Chris.
Lynn.
Hi, Emily, how are you?
Chris.
Nice to meet you.
Likewise.
Shall we?
So just the day after the Stone Mountain protests in Georgia, you decided to bring Chris and Emily together. Tell me about the backstory of getting them to meet and what happened when they did.
I think that came from the comments from both sides, and they would say that neither side wanted to communicate, they just wanted to protest, they just wanted to fight. Both sides would say that about each other. And so I thought, well, let's try and get them together and get them to communicate.
A while back, you were talking about, anti-fascists arming themselves and that you took issue with that. What makes that different from you and your militia?
They're arming themselves because they want to shoot people that don't agree with them.
As someone that's close with the anti-fascist movement, I would express to you that it's about protection. You know, we see how heavily the right has armed themselves. How is that not supposed to want us to arm ourselves as well?
Well, you know, if you look at it in that, from that one point of view, then yeah, we'll use the Second Amendment to defend the voice of the people, and you'll use the Second Amendment to defend the voice of the people. But those two voices are totally different, and it comes down to this: which side is going to uphold and defend the Constitution from all enemies, foreign and domestic? Which one is going to try to tear the country down and bring about some sort of socialist, communist, Marxist, anarchy, utopia, governing system? You're trying to change our constitutional republic.
They were able to have a reasonable discussion. I think they both obviously were aware of the fact that the cameras were on them, and so they didn't want to come off as the more unreasonable one. But essentially, I think they both wanted the dialogue. I think that they both went into it knowing that they couldn't change each other's mind, but they still wanted to be heard.
I hope that this conversation maybe helped you to understand that we're not terrorists and to maybe humanize anti-fascism.
Understood. And I would reciprocate. I would hope that out of this conversation you would see that a constitutional militia is not a racist organization.
There's obviously a big election coming up next year in the United States. You've seen these people up close at various extremes. What kinds of roles do you think they might play as America chooses its next president?
I think the next few months are going to be very interesting. You do have a bit of a split with Republicans now because you have the very far right, you have MAGA, and then you have the kind of more old guard Republicans who wouldn't necessarily go out on the streets and defend Donald Trump. And that to me is almost more dangerous in a way because it kind of ignites and allows the more niche extreme groups to be able to organize as they feel like they're really fighting the fight. I think we saw that with the Proud Boys. They felt like they were defending patriotism. They were fighting for Donald Trump. And when Donald Trump didn't win the election, they felt they had to get out there and try and do something about it.
And how do you think they'll use social media to continue to advance their agendas?
I think what is really interesting to me is that just like the media, social media in America is now very partisan and polarized. So you have people on the right who will probably go to Telegram, and obviously they go to Truth Social to talk to Trump fans. And then you'll have more people on the left who may still be on Twitter, for example. So even social media is becoming politicized. And I think there's something that we're going to see a lot more of. Let's remember that both the far left and far right mobilized because of Donald Trump's presidency, and with Trump running again, that could easily mean the potential of more civil unrest.
That's it for this episode of Trending. Thanks for listening. I'm Mike Wendling, and my thanks to Maxine Hughes for bringing us this story, and to our producer, Kayleen Devlin, and our editor, Flora Carmichael. If you want to get in touch with your thoughts on this or any of our programs, you can email me. My email is michael.wendling@bbc.co.uk.